Yeah, that's one that's nice and solid. Yep. Hello and a very warm welcome to my first ever prop related video. I'm Anthony for PB Props and Models, and today we're going to be looking at this little fella. Yes, it's none other than K9, Doctor Who's lovable robotic space pooch companion. The example we have here was recently purchased secondhand from a specialist memorabilia dealer. It's an officially licensed replica produced in fibreglass by This Planet Earth Ltd during the early to mid 2000s, and is currently out of production, making it a scarce and sought after collectible. As you can clearly see, the old dog has seen better days, and is looking rather sad and sorry for himself, which is why the owner has contracted me to bring him back up to spec, and get him looking presentable for future adventures in time and space, as well as his 40th anniversary, which is due this coming October of 2017. Looking at him from nose to tail, we can get a general idea of the work ahead of me. Perhaps the most obvious issue of concern is the position of the rather mournful looking head. Clearly something has broken on the mounting point inside that overlong neck, and so that has to be investigated and rectified. Detail-wise, the eye plate array is not only falling apart, but it is also significantly undersized, giving him quite an awkward squinty look, so that would need removing and remaking from scratch, as well as the non-existent ears. Moving to the back of the head, there are a number of rather unsightly cracks in the surface gel coat that will require some filler, but it's when we come to look at the main body that most of the work comes glaringly to light. While the main computer panel on his back is fine for the most part, it's the glue-ridden and sloppily positioned resin-cast lenses that need some serious attention, as not only is the paint flaking off even with the slightest glance, but they're not the correct colour or layout for the Mark II Season 16 Key to Time era version of the prop that this is meant to be. Just like the head, there are several significant cracks in the fibreglass body shell, as well as a multitude of very obvious casting defects that really detract from the overall look of the prop, so I know there's going to be an awful lot of filling and sanding ahead of me. Other factors to consider would be the removal and replacement of the tattered bumpers, the complete rebuild of the inaccurate and weedy looking tail with its perished rubber gaiter. The side monitor screen is not only cracking apart, but is also heavily scuffed, just like the rest of the body and the head, so it too will need a full respray. Having done the deed of divorcing the head from the body, I was rather surprised to see that a short piece of PVC plumbing pipe and two elbow joints were employed to surface mount the pair together with no consideration for offsetting and counterbalancing the mass of the head inside the body itself. With this in mind, I was curious to know just how much the head actually weighed, as it was obviously enough to stress that feeble neck armature to total failure, and so out came the scales. 1.6 kilos, or 3.5 pounds, were weighing down on nothing more than a few bits of plumbing, a handful of screws, and some filler, so it's no wonder it sheared right through. Speaking of filler, before moving on to the head, I wanted to remove that stubborn core that was still attached to the body. The answer was simply to use a bit of brute force and smash it off. Because I discovered that the head was, after all, comprised of two separate castings just like the original BBC prop, the main body of the head and the top lid, the plan now was to separate these two once more and make a feature of them. Doing so would allow me the added bonus of having full, unhindered access to the inside where I could build a new mount for the neck armature, as well as to give me enough room to potentially add in lights and insert an extendable eye probe. However, not long into the operation, trouble began as cracks and fissures started to appear. Now that wasn't good. Clearly I couldn't continue with this plan, and so I decided to abandon the whole idea and fix what I had started to undo. But it did come at a price. I'd now have to mount the new neck armature from the outside using the existing PVC elbow joint, which was an unfortunate compromise, but one that was still better than the original setup. Here you can see me applying just enough filler without overdoing it. The more you put on, the longer it takes to sound smooth, which is totally inefficient with regards to time, especially when you're on a commission with a tight deadline. I also green trim the filler before the material is fully cured. Again, this saves me a lot of time later when it comes to sanding the repaired area down. Finally, I wanted to find out why exactly the head casing was breaking apart, because really it shouldn't have been doing that at all, and so I decided to roll out the power tools and sand the paint off for a better look. What I discovered was interesting to say the least.
Okay, so the original plan was to take this section here off. It is actually a separate piece to this casting. However, as I was cracking this along here, a huge hole opened up here. You can just see the cracks here. Here's the gel coat where you can see the filler in behind it, actually inside the head. Now this goes all the way along here, you can see it's coming through, and then suddenly this area here is just pure filler, and then it's back to gel coat. So this whole section along here is really fragile, very thin, very brittle. So if I had have taken this top piece off, all this would have broken out, and that would have been a massive job to repair. Now the canine's head has been sanded and primed with a guide coat of grey primer, the next step is to start adding on the screw detail. Now, canine should have 9 screws, 2 down here, 2 down here, 2 on the other side, 2 underneath just here, and 1 here. Now, This Planet Earth have already put in 2 faux screws, so my job is to add in the other 7. Right, so it goes from there to there. That is 2 inches up, so 2 inches up to there. Same for the other side. Corner to corner. Double check, that should be about 2 inches. Yep. About 2 inches there. Just that mark. Now, 5 inches, 2.5 inches, come down a bit to about there. And here I've already marked out the position for the next 2. There's 1 here and 1 here, just a little bit set back from where the neck is. What am I hitting? Nope, body filler. Do the same for the other side. Actually, let's try putting it in like this. So, a bit of glue in there. That's the wider one. bit of glue in here. There's a smaller one at the top. Make sure they're not both the same orientation. So our 9 screws, there's the 2 there. 2 I've just put in here. That one there. Those 2, and of course, not forgetting the 2 underneath. Oh, doesn't he look super? Oh, there goes my knee. Well, some of these come off easier. Boink! Well, some of these want to come off and some of them don't. Boink! Uh-huh. Ouch! I meant to do that. Oh, okay. You're going to be difficult, are you? Okay. That one isn't. Oh, this one's bloody nailed on or something. Right. Persuasion stick. Hammer. And it's off. Can I get these things off? Ooh. What the hell is that? That feels like contact adhesive. Right. Mil. And 130 mil again. That's what the stuff is. It is an adhesive. It's an adhesive film, double-sided. Ooh, that's interesting. Yeah, same on that side as well. Easier than I thought. Good Lord, it's getting dark. I'm running out of time.
That's a lot of dirt. Wink. Oh my goodness me. Oh my god. That is a mess. Nice and smooth. Smooth.
Right, before I go any further, we've got a little bit of an issue here. If you can just see, the gel coat is cracking and it's gone right through and there's stuff all the way along here. Now there is a very easy quick fix, and that is dab. Super glue, you don't have to be too neat at this point. Just dab it on. And we're gonna smush that in a little bit. Let me get a scraper. Of course I don't have one to hand now, do I? Where's my little scraper? Ah, that will do. So I just smush that in all the way across there. Doesn't matter too much about neatness because we're going to sand all this down. That will be enough to hold it. Give it a little spray. That should set. Just come back and test it. Yep. Now, you'll see it's all a bit nasty. Simple solution to that. Sandpaper. Now this will put it back to how it was. There. Good as new. You wouldn't even know I was there. Thank you. nice tea towel.
Yeah, oh well.
Okay, fans, just for the sake of it, I'm using the exact same ruler and the exact same tile score that I used 20 years ago when I did the original wooden master for this. So, here we go. Last time I had to stick this thing down to a piece of, stick it down with a piece of double-sided sticky tape, and that wasn't the most successful because I couldn't get it off. And we're slipping forward. Just like last time. So a couple of light scores. The reason I'm doing this is because over the years where this thing has been cast, it's clearly filled in somewhat on this particular side. So here we go. I'm putting my finger there just to act as a guide so I don't go sliding off the groove. So more pressure. Really score into that gel coat and fiberglass. Effectively what I'm doing here is I'm redefining the pretend removable panel here. Now I'm just going over with a little file, just to smooth things off and open it up a little bit. So I've already scored this bit. This bit was okay, but I just want to try and clean it up. So just gentle, smooth movements. Just go up and down. You know when it's done is when it just feels really smooth as it goes up. So this is pretty much done there. Now here. That's pretty good. And now at this point I just want to blend it back into where the original score line from the casting is.
But actually, now that I look at it, shall I? Okay, it's pretty deep enough. Just want to try and clean it up a little bit. So it's a little bit bobbly. So, just run the file down it. Particularly bumpy just here. And I don't want to get too heavy on this. Just take out that there. There's a little bit to be done here. Just using my thumb here on the file just to keep it in place. Yep, much more refined now. You can really see it and it doesn't look so weird. Checking for symmetry. Yep. So it's got to be a snug fit right in there. That goes right in at least double the amount it used to. Of acetone. Just to explain what's going on here, I've seated this piece of timber that I shaped the end into a near point so I could get it really far into this elbow joint. What I've then done is I've screwed four screws. And these are actually positioning screws, so you stick it in, these screws go into the timber, and then I can tighten them or loosen them to make the neck or the spine go either that way or that way until I've got the whole thing straight and in alignment with the head. I've then backfilled with filler. That just gives something, you know, basically more solidity in here, whereas previously it was all going into tubes and pipes. And as you can see, this pipe here, this elbow joint, is quite badly distorted here. And that was because that's seated into there. Whoops. That's seated into there. And all the screws really were doing were going through the wall thickness, which is that plus that. And that allowed quite a bit of movement in there. And over time, the neck just sagged and sagged and sagged because of the weight of the 1.6 kilo head. So, doing it this method, it just gives the screws and the filler and the head all something to bite onto, so there's literally no give. So hopefully that will be substantial enough to support the head for a good many years, if not forever, hopefully. So while I'm waiting for the filler to cure in the spine seating on the head, the next thing I'm going to look at is the neck, and in particular, this neck. I don't know what this is, it's some sort of conduit or whatever that This Planet Earth have used. It's a little bit on the small side in terms of its diameter, but overall it's pretty good. So it's a little bit inflexible, but seeing as this is a static prop, that doesn't matter. What does matter is that as it stands, it's way too long. So I want to chop it down a bit. I mean, here it looks way too long, but if I put this on here, it doesn't look too bad until you put the head on it. I think I've worked out I need to remove two of these.
That allows me to bring the whole thing back by four, so the neck will end around there. Because what happens is this whole end here actually goes inside the head. Again, I'm not a big fan of that, but you've got to work with what you have. So I'm going to chop off two, have a look, see how it looks. If it looks not very good, I'll chop off another one, but I don't really want to go too far down. On the original canine, I think there's 30, yes there is, 13 ridges. So I think 13 is actually down here on this, but we can work with that. So as I said, X-Acto knife, just roughly cut along here and see how it looks.
Alright, I don't have to be too neat about this. Let's just cut through this, being very careful. Don't want to slice my fingers off, that's my usual trick. It's actually not too difficult to cut, slicing quite through. I mean, it's slicing quite nicely through. There we go. There we go. Shorten the neck. And if it's too short, I'm buggered. But it's not.
Alright. That's all there, good and solid. Yeah, happy with that. Let's see what these look like. Alright. Moment of truth. Okay. Oops. So that's roughly how it's going to look. Yeah, much better. And I've got a fair old amount of wiggle room there. Yeah, I think that's about right.
Smooth.
Wanker's cramp. Ouch, and that's hot. Okie dokie.
In.
noises, they're all technical. Whoops. We tend you to know your left from your right. Counterclockwise and clockwise. Ugh. Just creeping up on the hole. I've got to force it right, and otherwise it will bite and spin this right out of my hand and probably hurt me. Here's the thing no one wants you to do. Ow, that's hot. Ow. Perfect. Okay, forget screwing holes in bits of wood for now. What I've done is I've taken that plate and I've glued it in from the rear, just tacked it in with a bit of CA glue. So you can sort of see what I'm doing here. You've got these two bracket pieces with this this bolt here. And what that's going to do is that will go through the neck. Now, with the neck, rather than the timber constantly pivoting on this piece here, what I've done is I've actually cut a piece of aluminium tubing and pressure fitted it into this and super glued it into place just so it doesn't move, and that will act as a spacer, but also it'll act as a little bushing against this so that as the thing pivots, if it does pivot that is, this won't grind away at the timber. Instead it will just butt up against the inside of this piece of tubing. So anyway, that's the general plan. It seems to be working. All I need to do now is screw it all together. That's going to be a pain in the bum, trying to do it one-handed. Okie dokie, let's get on with it. Okay, I've done a little bit of work off camera. It's quite involved and I just didn't want to film myself struggling away trying to wrestle this into position, but as you can see, the head's on there. There's actually a bungee inside holding it down. So I've mounted the bungee just behind the front down here. I've also put on a tail, but we'll come to that bit in a minute. So, yeah. His head's pretty good, it's on really solidly, and I'm quite happy with its position, and I'm happy with the size of the neck. Now obviously the neck here is just sort of sat up against this, it really needs to poke actually inside this. This is how this head was originally designed to be, so I've got to fiddle with that. But in general I think it's pretty close to completion, so I think it's just effectively painted. Anyway, let's have a look at the tail. Okay, the tail has been mounted. This is actually one of the three prototype tails I made for This Planet Earth back in 96 or 98, I think it was. And what I've done here is I found it out in storage, and it's simply a matter of pressure fitting it. What I've done here, as we can see, boink! Just drilled this little hole out here, put in another piece of aluminium tubing, and then wrapped gaffer tape and masking tape around it, and that's just to act as a pressure fit. So you literally put this on, go and down, and that's pretty much it. That took me all of minutes to do. Here's a little tip. If you've got some sticky residue on something and you can't get it off no matter how much you scrape or put heat on it, something as simple as WD-40. There you go, just squirt it on there, give it a bit of a rub, and there we go. Stickiness free. Works every time. Okay, I'm getting to the end stage of this refurbishment, and really it's just details now, and I think I'm going to have a look at these resin pieces. They're meant to be metal, but metal, to my mind, is smooth, and this certainly is not smooth at all, I don't know if you can see that. It seems very, very pitted. You know, as I said, it is made of resin, but it's smooth on this side, but absolutely pitted here, so I'm going to try and get rid of that. General clean-up. So yeah, let's take some sandpaper and start smoothing.
That is a lot smoother, so yep, that's pretty good.
Ah, bugger!
Don't want to do too much. Let's just have a quick look. Dunk, dunk, dunk. What I'm doing here is I'm slightly going to flood the surface. The reason for that is I want it to have a slightly wet and slick look. That just sort of really helps with the glossiness. Anyway, let's continue. Right, stop. Don't do any more, otherwise you will bugger it up. Right, we're going to have to make this quick before the sun sets too much. The silver stuff. Here's the handle, all nicely sprayed. But this is what I really want to look at. This has come up really nicely. I mean, to the touch, it's very silky, very glossy. This is because I sprayed on the silver really heavy, almost to the point where it looked like it was going to dribble. I'm not entirely sure if you can see it. It's probably too dim and dingy out here now to see this. But yeah, it's got a real slick, glossy look, which is just what I was hoping for. Yeah, there are a couple of dimples in here. They're casting defects, nothing I could do about that. I could have filled it, but to be honest, it's barely noticeable. So yeah, you've got that. You've got that one. Oh yeah, that looks really nice. Have to have a look at this again in the light. And that. So, yeah, I'm happy with that. Very happy indeed. Okay, just a little one there. There's a little crack here, goes all the way through. You can just about see it there. I'm going to try and patch that. Got to be really judicious. So, what's going to happen is I'm going to push it through to the other side. So, going to be a bit of back and forth. Actually, let's just use the finger, it's easier. Back and forth, back and forth. And that will come through to the other side, as you can see. Now, just smush it. Back to the other side. There we are. Now, it's all in my hands. Take a little bit of that acetone. I'm just going to blend it. Not too much. Like that. Just gently blend it. And do the same for the other side. See, the acetone just allows you to work the body filler. It does retard its curing, but that's kind of in our favour, so that's why we do it. Right. Okie dokie, that looks... hang on. That looks like it'll do the trick.
Well, that's a good sign. It's not ripping up the grey undercoat. I was a bit worried about that. Okie dokie.
Right, and now for the blue tape. It's coming up rather well. That is a bit sticky. Please don't rip up the grey. Ooh. No bleed. That was very good. I'm happy about that. No bleed whatsoever. Ah, crap, there's a little bit of bleed there. Never mind. Overall, that's not too bad, save for that bit, but I can actually buff that out. That's fine.
Let's just have a quick look what this looks like. Right. Cleaned up the screen, took that little black mark off. It's just a bit of water and a cloth. Tidied up the edges. It looks all right, I think. Don't like the contrast at the minute, but soon all this will be grey. So he is looking alright. Happy with that.
We're on the final stretch now, so it's really just details. And as you can probably guess, what I'm working on here is K9's faceplate. This is created out of sheet styrene. So I've got some 2mm for the strips, and I think it's 0.5mm for the backing plate. So what I need to do now is just start gluing them in. And what I'm using is liquid solvent cement. The process is not involved, but I'm going to tack them down. So this bit here is actually separate to this bit, and I'll come to that much later. So I want to tack all of these to that. So I'll do the first two, and then I'll do the rest off camera. So yeah,
okay, here we go.
So make sure it's right in the corner, hold that down. I do not want to touch this end, because as I said, this is separate to that. I just want these set to that. So we're in, and just put a little bit on, press it down, and pray that it stays there. That looks like it's going to stay. Just put a little bit more on. Don't want too much, otherwise I'll dissolve this stuff. See how fiddly this can be. There we are, that's one. Is that stuck? Yeah, that's stuck. So put the next one in, that's the bottom one. Push that right into the corner. Okay. Just glue this side first, don't want to go too far. Capillary reaction will take this very thin water-like adhesive or solvent underneath it. I mean, I will do it again later once all of the pieces are on, but for now I just want to literally tack it into place. So excuse my fingers. You know, you kind of are in the way here. So that's the beginnings of it. I just have to do three more, so I'm going to do that off camera because I need the space and you're in the way. I've skipped ahead a little bit now. I've stuck the five pieces to this backing plate. All this will be red, and you'll see here is the rest of the backing plate. This is the detail that quite often gets missed. It's actually meant to be black. So this sticks into that, and then the whole lot sticks onto the front of the face. I'm now going to glue this a bit more. We'll use solvent on it a bit more. Almost forgot what I was going to say there. So, I have a nasty suspicion too that the paintbrush I'm using is actually synthetic. Which is not good, because it means the solvent that I'm using is slightly melting it. Either that or there's some peculiar dye in this, because the glue keeps turning orange. So what I'm doing here is I'm just now gluing it from the rear side to make well and truly sure that this stuff stays together. I can tell you, the plastic handle on this thing is melting and it's sticking to my fingers. Again, not good. Oh, and just in case any of you health and safety nerds are out there worrying, I'm in a well-ventilated area, just as I always am. My double doors are open, so I'm not going to be affected by any fumes. And no, I'm not wearing a mask, but I am wearing a high-vis safety jacket, so clearly I'm bulletproof, radiation-proof, and totally indestructible, so I wouldn't worry too much about it. And excuse my hands being in the way. Right, that's that done. Time to... what do I have to do next? Oh yeah, got to make a little hole in it for the little eye thing. Undercoat it, spray that black, that red. Okay, I'll get on with that then. As you can see, the eye plate is now completed. I kept them separate purely so I could spray them individually. I didn't want to go sticking them both together and then having to spray it red and then paint out by hand the black bits. So yeah, literally, that's that. Holy sharp intake of breath, Batman! It's sunny outside and warm and not windy! That means I can go and paint Canine's body and head! Fantastic! While we're on the subject of paints, here's a quick aside. These are all the paints I've used on the Canine project thus far. Believe it or not, this is about £120 worth of paint. Each of these cost about £8 and those cost about a tenner. And yeah, you always find that on any project, you always need more paint than you think. I tend to try and budget about 50% over what I want. Usually, that's not enough. When we started the Canine, I was given two of those, one of those, and that. And I knew that wasn't enough, and the client knew it wasn't enough. But I did warn him that every time you do a job that involves spray painting, especially with automotive paint, it's never going to be cheap. Okay, everything you see here is all the materials and tools and supplies we need to make Canine's ears. The main basis is this aluminium mesh. You can buy this if you're in the UK. Down at Halfords, it's in the car repair area, along with the fibreglass and the fillers and what have you. This is capillary wire. I've had that for 20 years. In fact, this is the exact same wire that I used to make the original prototypes back in 96 or 8. Rings, I have no clue whether you can buy these today, but these again are left over from the original builds that I did. So it's going to be all super glued together. We could sit there and braze it together or solder it together, but I don't think it's worth it, to be honest. So anyway, oh, and the tea, that is the most vital part of it all. We need tea. A for liquid refreshment and B to curve the ear crisp around like so. We just bend it round once it's all assembled. Speaking of crisps, this is the sole surviving ear from the dog that we're repairing. I'm going to use this as a template. I'm simply going to drop it on there and cut round it. It just saves a lot of time and a lot of shag, to be honest. So effectively it's going to be bending bits of wire. I think this is 1 millimeter brass wire. So that will form like an L shape in here. These things here will sit on it because there's little rings, there's three rings, in fact it goes like that. Two rings that way, a smaller ring that way, and a piece of this bent in an L shape through here. And as a little spacer, got a little plastic tube here. Actually it's from a cotton bud, and it's the perfect diameter to sit inside this, like so. So that will sit in there and act as a spacer under there, like that. So, and then this will bend up this way, and yeah, it's lots of gluing. As I said, it's not going to be the most robust and strong build, but it doesn't need to, because hopefully you don't sit there grabbing the things and trying to rip them off. So I'm going to crack on with this, and I'm going to start with the crisp. Okay, as you can see, I've made the two ears now. This is the fiddly stage. You make it flat and glue it all together. then once you've got that, you take your mug and you carefully bend it around the perimeter of the mug. Now, doing that, all this mesh will ping off. So you have your handy super glue and you just keep re-gluing it. And the whole point of this, really, there's no getting around it. You're constantly gluing, it'll snap off, it'll ping off, you re-glue it, and you just repeat the process over and over again. So I am now on the stage of just preening this. I think I've done this one, I think. So I'm just taking some coarse sandpaper. I think this is 80 grit. And I'm just going around, just trying to clean it up a little bit. So you go all the way around the edge. I've already filed it, by the way, just so I know that the fit is snug. So now I'm just trying to get rid of the extraneous glue residue. But as I say, this is a really tedious and frustrating part of the process, but it's just got to be done. And you will be sitting there, if you're going to be building your own ones, swearing and cursing canine's ears. I mean, there are other ways to do it, but we're just replicating the way the TP ones were done, so I don't really have a choice in the matter. So yeah, it's just a matter of cleaning these up. You know, the glue is going to get everywhere. There's no escaping that. It's just about managing the fallout. So as you can see, I'm just going round it with this 80 grit. Just trying to get it looking a bit nicer than it was. You know, it may even ping when I'm doing this, and that would be a bit of an annoyance if it does, but just live with it. As I said, there are better ways of doing this, but I can't find the stuff that I wanted to use, but this is meant to be a TP dog, and the owner wants it to remain in its TP guise. So, you do as you're told. Just going around it with, what's this? I think this may be 100 grit or 120, I'm not sure. And just to finish up, some wire wool. Okay, I'm going to carry on with this and do the other one. So we're now at the world's smallest vise, and I'm just about to make the stems for the ears. I've got two 1mm, I think a brass strip, and I'm intending to bend them both at the same time, because what happens is on K9 it goes up, comes out, and then bends back down again. And I'm doing the little bend, and I want this at a 45 degree angle, so if I can get it as close as I can, that will be just fantastic. So that's 45 degrees there, 45, 90 degrees. Now I've got another one, and that goes, hang on, so that goes in there. So another mark. I've marked these incrementally with a marker pen. Now this bit's kind of critical, so I need to just get it nice and straight. Just grip the thing on first. Right. Needs to come up slightly. Tighten that off. I do have more markers, but this is where the space is going to go, and then this bit here goes into the head. So this is the last bend that I need to do. Come on. There we go. Just need to come back on myself. And that looks like it. Now I've given these two a bit of a rub down. In fact, these three a bit of a rub down. And now it's a case of hoping this is all going to glue. I just want to try and lightly tack it first. I don't want too much glue. See if I can do enough with just this small amount. Just tack it down. Okay. That's good. So yeah, the idea here is just to quickly and lightly tack it down, let that set, and then go at it again with a bit more glue.
But as you can see, what I've done here is this is the piece we've just bent, and you've got the two bigger rings, and there is a smaller ring that will sit just up here, but we'll come to that a bit later. I may do it off camera. So as you can see, this one, or you might be able to see, this one here is very slightly offset to this one. It's actually further back. And you'll notice I just had my ruler there and it was butted up against the ruler. If I had this in line with that one, that means when I come to glue it to this, there's going to be a gap behind here and in front of this, which we don't want. So that's how that's going to go. So, yeah, from here it's re-glue this again, add on another one, and then actually, when we have this sat in like that, there are also two support rods going from here to here and here to here, and they sit underneath this tertiary smaller ring, so that will give a bit of extra strength there. But we'll come to that in due course. First of all, let this dry. Hang on. Excuse me. Right, okay. Manners. As you can see, I've now jumped ahead and the little brass assembly is now on. And in this state, it's at its most fragile because everything's just tacked together. You'll also notice I've got these little standoffs here. That's to stop the ear sinking too far down into the head. So this little strut goes through the little standoffs on the head, and then you've got a secondary standoff here and here, and that stops it going down too far. Now my next stage is to add in the little struts that go from here to here, and from here to here, and the same on this side. Again, talking about the strength, if I'd managed to find some flux, I would have been able to solder this together. I mean, I've got this big plumber's solder, but I went into a shop earlier today, no, not today, 2 days ago I think it was, to go and buy some bits and pieces, and I said to them, oh, do you have solder? Yep, so they got me some solder. Do you have some flux to go with it? Oh, no, we don't sell flux. So I thought, well, maybe the solder that they have is the solder with the flux in the core. No, it wasn't. So kind of made me wonder why they sold it, because on their own, these things are pretty damn useless. So anyway, that's the reason why we've gone down the super glue route. So, yep, my next step is to add on these little bits, and then it's painting, and then sticking them on the dog. Oh God, excuse me. I've got the burps today. Right, crack on. Well, the little supports are now in, and I'm just letting it stand for a while, because even though I've used the activator on the super glue, I still like to let it stand for a while and let it really cure and harden off. Oh, and by the way, a little word of caution. This thing is a really fiddly job, and when you're using your super glue, you're going to be your fingers and thumbs, and you're sort of dabbing it in. And because it wants to fall apart as you're doing it, you need to kick it with this stuff and set it off. However, if you happen to get super glue on your thumb like I have, in fact, all over my thumb and fingers, and all over here, and you happen to spray this and get that on you as well, it's going to burn like buggery. It really, really hurts. So yeah, just be careful. I'm kind of used to it now. I've burnt myself so many times because I'm just clumsy like that. But yeah, if you get super glue on your hands and then you activate it and speed cure it, it's going to burn and it's going to hurt. Anyway, back to ears. These are completed. I might do a final little pass of sanding, and then it's painting and then sticking them on the dog. Okay, I'm having to spray inside at the moment because it's really, really windy outside and I'm never going to be able to do it properly. So, yep, it's a case of laying this board down and just spraying, holding me breath. Don't whinge. Should have sprayed them there to start with. First off, I must congratulate you that you made it this far into the video. I think we're about 70 odd minutes. So well done on that one, and if you fast forwarded right to the end, shame on you. Well, I'm rather pleased to say that K9's finished, and he turned out a lot better than I had anticipated. There were a few troubles along the way, one of the prime issues being the sheer amount of scuffs and dings on the body. But the owner said he wanted this to be the ultimate TPE K9, but he left it to my discretion to do what basically I wanted to do with it. So I've tried to keep all the attributes of the original TPE build, but I've tried to sort of nudge it back to where I had originally envisaged it. So what I've done, simple things like the colour, it's gunmetal grey, but rather than just having a totally smooth and pure finish to it, I went over it with wet or dry sandpaper just to not destroy the finish, but to give it a kind of sense of wear, just to give it a little bit more authenticity, to make it appear a bit more realistic. So in general, I'm pleased with the outcome. It's got a new tail of it, new covered collar, better eye, certainly better ears, black bumpers for the first time. I did redo these. I completely made them smooth because they were very, very pitted. So yeah, there's not much more I can say, really. It's just a case of now waiting for his owner to come and pick him up and take him away. You just have to see him go. It's also a bit of a full circle project, one of the very first commercial things I did, and here it is, literally 20 odd years later, and I'm back doing K9. Oh well, thanks for watching.